Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Today we start the chapter on transport in plants. I know usually students do not like the plant chapters very much, but they're not so bad. I think they can be made a little interesting. If I could take you on a nature walk and show you all the trees and explain all the chapter in more detail, but I'm sure that's not possible. Okay, so looking at the chapter on transport in plants, we need to know, number one, the structure of the leaf. We need to revise that. We need to know what is the vascular bundles, because transport in plants is in the vascular bundles, and there are two parts of the vascular bundle which we have to understand. One is the xylem and the other is the phloem. Xylem is going to transport water and ions, and phloem is going to transport food. But please do not write food. Food won't be correct biological English. It's going to transport sucrose. And this sucrose is going to be in solution. So we're going to be studying this, and we start first looking at the syllabus, and then we go on to the details of this chapter. The syllabus is transport in flowering plants is water and ion uptake. That in that we have to know the root hair cell, and it details how water and ions are taken up from the soil. And then we have to know two other terms, transpiration and translocation. Transpiration is all about the water passing out of the leaves as water vapors. Translocation is all about the movement in the phloem. So the phloem story is all translocation, and the transpiration story is all about the xylem. Now, looking at the general overview of this chapter, there's only one investigate here, and there is another investigate here of, this is the investigate here. The effects of air currents and the variation of temperature, humidity and light intensity on the rate of transpiration. So these are the two investigates. So this is the practical that we have to understand, and this is the practical that we have to understand. Then we have to understand the position of the xylem and phloem and the functions of the xylem and phloem. So just like in the human transport system, we would study arteries and veins and the pump, which is the heart. Here we have no arteries and veins. But here we have two separate systems. Here in the human system, the arteries and veins are connected by capillaries. But here they are not connected by anything. They are two separate systems. The xylem is a separate and phloem is a separate system. So please understand this, and then we develop further details of this chapter. Now just an overview. Xylem transports water and ions from the soil to the different parts of the plant. So water first has to enter the root hair cell, and then it goes cell to cell, and then of course it enters the xylem and then is pulled up. It's just like you have a glass of water and you have a straw in it. Now what the suction force that you apply is going to pull up the water into the straw. So what you have to understand is that the suction force in a plant would be the leaves, the water coming out of the leaves. So that provides a suction force, and water is pulled up into the leaves because it is moving out of the leaves. So the suction force which you apply when you drink water from a straw, the suction force in the leaf is the water vapors moving out. So inside there, water is in the form of a liquid. It has to first evaporate, and then it is passed out of the leaf as water vapors. You write water passes out of the leaf. Now that's wrong. That's wrong. You're not correctly wording it. Water doesn't come out in a liquid state. It moves out as a gaseous state. So water vapor is the word that you need to write. If you write water, I mean, we don't give you any marks, because it's not water, it's not liquid water which is coming out of the leaves. So a basic understanding you must have how you use the word water and how you use and when you use the word water vapor. Now the second thing is the phloem. Now the phloem transports what? Sucrose and amino acids in solution, not in a dry state, from source to sink. Source will be where it is provided, like the leaf I said, the other examples of source which I'm going to give you. And sink would be the roots where no photosynthesis takes place and there's no light, and they need glucose to respire and release energy. So source is the provider and the sink is the user. Now this may not be given in your O-level books, but I want you to understand this. So phloem transports sucrose and amino acids in solution from source, which could be the leaf where it's made glucose, and then the glucose is converted into a disaccharide which is called sucrose. And the sink is the part of the plant which is unable to photosynthesize, like the root or a white flower or a red flower. And there it needs to be transported to that area so that that area is can also grow, and it is living. It has to grow and provide a large root surface area for the absorption of water as the plant grows. So source to sink. Now I would like to talk a little bit about the development of the xylem. How did the xylem develop? Basically, the xylem developed was once upon a time they were just ordinary elongated cells joined end to end. These ones here, A. So normal cells have a cell wall, cell membrane, cytoplasm, large central vacuole. They have all the contents. Now the cross walls break. So this cross wall breaks here, 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 here. Now you can see here in the next diagram, I've drawn these remains of the cross walls. You can see the remains of the cross walls. So I said cross walls break. Cell contents die. So there's no longer any cytoplasm, there's no longer any nucleus, there's no longer any other organelles. So all the cell contents die. And this forms a hollow continuous channel forms. Because now there are no cross walls, so it's now continuous, sort of like a straw or a tube. And then what is going to happen is lignin is going to be deposited in it. Now you see this lignin being deposited. And this lignin can be deposited in many ways, like a spiral form at times, and sometimes it's just little circles. So different ways lignin is deposited. But basically, what does the lignin do? The lignin strengthens this so that it can suck it up. The water and the ions can be sucked up, and you know, some very tall trees, the water has to be sucked up many meters. I mean, the trees are very, very tall. So the lignin is deposited and water and ions will be traveling up these tubes to different parts of the plant. So the deposition of lignin is very, very important. You need to understand that. So the lignin is deposited. I've used the same color to signify that. And I have shown you that how, what was it previously? Previously, these were normal cells joined end to end, normal cells. And then what happened is that the cross walls are broken and cell contents die. Now, you usually write xylem is dead. Now, this is totally wrong. Why is it wrong? Because a dead bird is not hollow. Now, what do you mean when you say xylem is dead? Now, it's a lot of BS, but beautiful story, BS. Xylem is dead means what? Well, you meant to say that xylem is hollow, but you said xylem is dead. And then you said your teacher didn't give you a mark. Well, she didn't give you a mark because it's wrong. It's wrong to say xylem is dead. Xylem is made up of hollow continuous channels. Well, that's fine if you wrote that. But because you keep on thinking that cell contents die, so So you think xylem is dead? Well, that's not the case. Xylem is dead, we mean is xylem does not have any living cell contents. But please remember, anything dead is not hollow. A dead bird is not hollow. A dead dog is not hollow. A dead tree is not hollow. So these are the wrong terminologies that you use in your exams, and then you say that you didn't get good marks in your exams. This is because you did not write the correct biological English. Now let's look at the structure of the phloem. Phloem is also called sieve tubes. Now, originally they were elongated cells joined end to end, just like we talked about in the xylem. And now here, it's very different than xylem. There's no sort of cell contents are still there. So cross walls develop pores, and these are called sieve plates. It's like a strainer or a chhanni in Urdu, like you strain your tea. So the sieve plate, sieve is a word which you need to, if you don't know it, well, you need to look it up in the dictionary. So sieve plates. Then there's no tonoplast. And remember, tonoplast was the vacuole membrane. So there's no vacuole membrane because we want space here. And there's a little bit of cytoplasm on the edges. I said a thin rim of cytoplasm. So if the cytoplasm is present, that means living, because cytoplasm would have living in it. So thin rim of cytoplasm, and these hollow tubes, what are they going to be transporting? They're going to be transporting sucrose in solution. So this is a liquid which is going to be transported. It's a very, very, sucrose is the sugar that we use at home. It's a disaccharide. It's made of glucose and fructose. So sucrose in solution will be transported in the phloem from source to sink. Okay, we need to now discuss this. What is source and what is sink? Now, what is source and what is sink? Let's now understand this point of the syllabus, the details of it, which is, of course, I like to give it to you in O levels, but may not be very much relevant to the present syllabus, but then you can be asked any questions on that. So in 2018, say we have a potato plant and we have these potatoes developing on it. Now the potatoes develop in the soil, you know. So the potatoes develop, and in this situation, these potatoes, when they are developing, they are the sink and the leaves are the source. Leaves are the source because this is where the glucose is being made, and the glucose is then being converted. So glucose is being converted, plus some of it is being converted to fructose, and the sucrose is being made. So the sucrose which is being made in the leaves is transported and is deposited in the potatoes as starch. So the source is the leaves in 2018. And the sink is the potatoes which are developing. So this is the sink in 2018. But then in 2019, when we took these same potatoes, and they are now big potatoes, and we cut it up into pieces, and we planted a little piece of potato, and this potato started to develop. It developed the roots, and then it developed the shoot. Please remember, potatoes act as seeds. So the same potato, you cut it up into two or three pieces and you put it in the soil and you see it start to grow. Now the same potato which was developing in 2018 here was a sink. But the same potato, when we have planted it in the soil in 2019, now this is the source. So source and sink. Source means, I always say source means the provider. You can't say source is always the part which photosynthesizes, because all the time that isn't the case. So source is the provider, and at times they are leaves which can photosynthesize, so they are the providers. So the sink is the part which is the user. So the sink is the user, like roots are the user, or here when the potatoes were developing, they were users. So what we need to understand is what is the source and what is the sink. And the phloem transports the sucrose from the source to the sink. So basically phloem has sucrose in solution, it has amino acids in solution, it even has ions. And it has plant growth regulators. All those are transported in the phloem. Now the next point of the syllabus, which is of course later in the chapter, but I am sort of discussing it earlier, is the position of the xylem and phloem in transverse sections of unthickened herbaceous dicotyledonous roots, stems and leaf. So whenever you're looking at thinking of a root, please always think of a carrot. And if you look at a carrot lengthwise, you see there's a white portion inside it. Now that white portion is actually the xylem. And that's not very nice to taste. And if you make a halwa of carrots, you know, gajar ka halwa, you always remove that white portion because otherwise the halwa is not going to taste very nice. So xylem in the center like a cross. And then we've got the phloem on the sides, which I've drawn in red. Now, when you look at a stem, you see the function of the root is very different. It's got to sort of burrow into the soil. But a stem has to grow up and it has to be strong. Why has it got to be strong? Because it should not break in the wind. If there is a strong wind blowing, it should just bend a little, but it should not break. So it has to be very sturdy and very strong. So in order to have that, what do we have? We have the vascular bundles are all on the sides. They're not in the center, they're all on the sides. So that's going to give a lot of strength to the stem. Because the stem is going to have the branches and the leaves and all that on it. So it's going to carry a lot of weight. Now, the xylem is on the inside. So the xylem is in the inside of all the vascular bundles. And then the phloem is on the outside. Why the phloem is on the outside? Well, you know, the aphids can also suck nice sugary sucrose in solution from the phloem, which is on the outside. So the phloem is on the outside. I've drawn it all in the same color. So please understand that I'm using the same color coding. So everybody should be very clear about that. Then when we cut a section of the leaf, it's a transverse section of the leaf, we find we've got the midrib. So this is the midrib. Now, in the midrib, what you've got to understand is that you have got a very large vascular bundle. Now, what we have to remember is leaf, upper, xylem. So leaf, upper, xylem. Please understand, we remember that's not the Lux soap that you use. So leaf, upper, xylem. So the xylem is always on the top because the midrib, please remember, has this sort of the thing, the part which is going to be like dipping down. So just take a leaf, just go and pick a leaf. Don't pick a leaf, but just look at it when it's on the tree. I hate it when you break leaves and flowers. So leaf, upper, xylem. So the xylem is all on the top. And we've got the phloem here. Well, that's just the way it is because it's just going to spread all over. So leaf, upper, xylem, and of course this part is the phloem. Now, how is this going to be helping this leaf is because this midrib is that thick one vessel which is going to the main pipe, you can say, which transports water and all that. And that's what these branches. And then further branches. So there's a network of veins which is going to transport water and of course the sucrose to all parts of the leaf, and it's going to actually take it away as well, because when the plant photosynthesizes, the glucose that is made is then passed into the phloem, and the phloem is going to carry it away, not as glucose but as sucrose. And please remember, never as starch, because starch is insoluble, so it could not be transported in a watery medium. And the phloem sap is a watery solution which is transported all over the plant. So position of xylem and phloem. Now this is a diagram which shows you the cross section of the root and the stem. And this, of course, shows you the leaf in a cross section, the upper epidermis, the palisade, the spongy, and then you've got the xylem at the top and the phloem at the bottom. There's the main vein or the midrib. And then you've got these different ones which have been cut across, these ones here, which you can see here and here and here and here. So the different vascular bundles can be seen. Then we've got the stem, and you can see the stem has all these on the sides. I call them at the periphery. Try the Freethi caught a catch at the periphery. Periphery means on the outside. And then we have the root. And for this, you need to look up a carrot. If you see a carrot and cut it lengthwise, you can see how the mid area is whitish, and that is the xylem. And the root has the xylem in the center, like a sort of a cross shaped. And then it's got the phloem on the sides. Now let's look at the definition of transpiration. Now, as per the syllabus, it says, number one, it is the evaporation of water. Secondly, from the surfaces of the mesophyll cells. And then this is followed by the loss of water vapor from the leaves through the stomata. So, first of all, the water has to evaporate. But where has to evaporate? It is evaporate from the surfaces of the mesophyll cells. And then in a vapor state, it has to go out of the leaves through the stomata. Now let's look at the structure of a stomata. Now that's very easy. There's a guard cell, and it's got a thickened inner guard cell wall. So thickened inner wall of the guard cell, the epidermal cells which are surrounding it. The guard cells have a nucleus. They have this opening which is called a stoma, and the guard cells have got chloroplast. So this is a surface view of it, and then this is a cross-section view of it. So please try to look at it in a sort of a careful manner and understand that this would be the surface view. That is, you're looking at the leaf, you know, these are the stomata on the lower surface of the leaf. So you're looking at it from the top, and here, of course, is the section of it. Then this is how the stomata look under the microscope. Because if you make a microscope, which is called epidermal peel of the leaf, you see these structures, and these structures are the stomata which are found. And of course, please remember, what we have to understand is that if we ever have to discuss this in A-levels, we talk of stomatal density. And this, of course, is very important, because stomatal density will determine the rate of how much water moves out of the, how much of the water vapors are going to go diffuse out of these stomata. If they are more stomata or they are less stomata. So those plants which have less stomata will survive in drought conditions. But those that have more stomata then will be difficult. They will not. And so natural selection will take place. And some of these plants will die and some will survive. Because if there's a drought for a very long time, then these plants will be at a disadvantage, those which have a higher stomatal density. Stomatal density, higher means more the stomata per unit area and less the stomata per unit area. So please remember this diagram. You need to be very careful in seeing that these are the stomata which have been taken from a epidermal peel and they've been examined under the microscope. Now let's look at the movement of water in a leaf. First of all, the most important is when the water moves out of the xylem. That's one. Now please remember, this is not osmosis. Why is it not osmosis? One is not osmosis. Why is it not osmosis? Because there is no partially permeable membrane. There is no partially permeable membrane. There is no cell membrane. There is no partially permeable membrane in the xylem. So this cannot be osmosis. So it will be diffusion. So water moves out of the xylem. Water moves into the palisade cells, here or here. So this will be two. Number two will be osmosis. So water moving out of the xylem and into either this palisade or the spongy mesophyll cell will be osmosis. So water goes into the cell. Now the same water molecules is also found on the surface. So it's going to move out and is present on the surface of the mesophyll cells. So again, this will be osmosis, because even going into the cell will be osmosis and out of the cell will also be osmosis. Now here another phenomena is going to happen. The other phenomena which is going to happen is, now in this situation, what we're going to, I'm going to give it another color. Here what is going to happen is, from a liquid state, this is going to become a gaseous state. So this is now number three. Number three will be evaporation. Because what has happened is that the liquid, which was on the surface of the liquid water, which was on the surface of the spongy mesophyll cells, is now going to be converted into a gaseous state. So this is going to be evaporation. Now, when evaporation has occurred, there will be lots and lots of water vapors in these air spaces. Now, all these water vapors in the air spaces now can move out. But will it move out or will it not move out? That's a very important question. It will only move out if there is a diffusion gradient. So water vapors will diffuse out only if they are high inside here and low inside here. If outside there is a lot of water vapor, like in June, July, there's a lot of humidity. Humidity means there are a lot of water vapors outside as well. So if there are more water vapors outside, then it's not going to diffuse out. And this movement of water vapors out of the leaf through the stomata is called transpiration. Is called transpiration. It is also diffusion of water vapors. You can also say that, but the technical name of it is transpiration. So the movement of water vapors, number one, out of the xylem is not osmosis. Then number two is osmosis, wherever I've written two is osmosis. And then three is when from a liquid state, it becomes a gaseous state. Like for instance, you've just washed your hair, you've got water on your hair, and then you use a blow dryer or hair dryer and you immediately see that the water, your hair dries up. Why does it dry up? Because the water now from a liquid state has become a gaseous state. So now that water is now in the air in your room. So you've helped it, when you've used a hair dryer, you've helped it to evaporate. You have increased the rate of evaporation. If you just left it, well, it would take its own time and evaporate. So when you've used a hair dryer, you have actually helped it in converting from a liquid state to a gaseous state. So evaporation is going to take place on the surface of the mesophyll cells. Now let's look at this definition again. I said evaporation of water at the surface of the mesophyll cells, followed by the loss of water vapor from the leaves through the stomata. You need to please remember this definition, and you must remember it. Why have I written it in points? So that's easier for you to recall it when you're writing it in the exam. So transpiration. Now I will finish this video here, and then I will continue the rest of the chapter in the second video, which will follow after this.